So they've been introduced, but interestingly, I have a set of three ayers. And I've been asked specifically not to make bad ayer jokes. But what's important is you've got three ayers and three boys. None of them are ayers, all right? Okay, let me ask you guys first. What's the biggest thing that happened in the last 2 weeks? Sir, there again, loudly. Okay. That margin of victory, did anyone expect? Sorry?
Access for India Today poll.
Absolutely. How can I forget? All right. Now, just tell me one thing. What do you guys think is the single largest achievement that Mr. Modi actually did or made in these elections? There's one metric, very interesting metric, which is really completely out of whack.
Branding and reaching out to all products.
Metric. Well, that was the cause. But just think about this. In the last elections, the BJP got a 31% vote share and got 282 seats. In this elections, the same team got a 38% vote share. Right? A 7% swing in your favor is unheard of in the world. Just to give you perspective, 7% converts to 63 million voters, which you have got on your side now from the last time. 63 million in context is as big as the entire population of England or Germany. That's the change that was made. Get it? That's huge. Okay, now my question is, how many people in this audience, just put your hands up, believe that digital had nothing to do with it? How many people in this audience believe that digital had nothing to do with this huge victory? For the naysayers, I've just got a quick example for you, and I haven't shared it with my panelists also. How many people in this audience have heard of a guy called Amit Vandana? Just makes my point. So Amit Vandana is a guy who's a stand-up comedian, caters to the class 3 and below population of India, class 3 towns and below, right? Before Jio, he had a following of 6 lakh viewers. After Jio, he has 15 million viewers. You never heard of this guy, right? That's what happening is with digital in the rural areas. And that's the kind of achievement you can get as reflected in the last elections. Just to put this in context, somebody like the viral fever, right, PVF, has 6 million viewers today after so many years. This guy's got 15 million, right? I've just taken this example to set the ball rolling because every one of us, whichever side of the political divide you might be, were equally surprised at the mammoth achievement. You can blame EVM machines and all that, but that's neither here nor there, right? But even the exit poll said it was going to be so big. So it can't be the EVM machines, right? And that's the margin of victory. That's the extent of victory. It obviously means with somebody like Amit Vandana, who's a good reflection of this, it means that we are in a digital age and it means that we are going to compete in digital. But at the end of the day, that's what I want to really get talking about around this table, is that it's still about business. And business in this age seems to have 4 characteristics before I start the discussion. One is we know there's huge opportunity there. It's clear it's growing. Our headroom in a country like India is still massive, substantial. Second also is that the number of players getting in to take a share of that pie is also enormous. Think about this data. The life expectancy of the average business in India today is 6%. Which means that 94 businesses are going to die before their 5th year, which is also true. In the middle of this, you have a customer, that horrible animal, who's become highly demanding, who's become completely, unforgiving, and yet the same consumer has very little attention span. And that's what's happening because of digital. You guys agree with that? No. If you don't agree, I'll go and ask them if they agree. All right. So with that in mind, we thought we will explore basically 5 big questions around this, right? And these are going to be really about the health of businesses rather than digital itself. The question is, in a digital age, how do you manage those 5 things, right? So can I set the ball rolling? You know, forever there has been debate between building recognition for brands and building relevance. Recognition is just out there so that in a moment it passes, it's transactional. Healthy businesses have to build relevance for themselves. Why do you think that we are still far behind, or do you think we are far behind in building relevance as against recognition? Just a data point here to start it off. You know, David Acker's Profit runs an index called the Brand Relevance Index. Right? And we find that the guys in the top 10 of the Brand Relevance Index actually outperform the S&P by 1:3. Okay. Who wants to go first? Ashutosh?
Can I?
Yeah.
So that I can skip from 2 hours.
I hope you do survive.
Yeah, thank you so much. I'm Ashutosh. Let me pick a few words from what Ramesh has said. One is business. I think second is relevance. The third is brand, or the brands. And if we go and try and address the very basic of brand relevance and business, what comes in my mind, whatever is the age, it's a digital age or even whatever age we want to say, I think the brand, and the very basic of my opinion, the brand is to make money, and brand has to make more and more money, correct? So that's number one. And number two is brand needs to be relevant, not for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. Brand needs to be relevant for maybe 100 years or 200 years. I pick up another thing which Ramesh said, and I think some of us would be surprised that 94% companies actually fail. But in between, I attended one program and where, I was told about one fact that if you take all the companies which are listed on the stock exchange and find out which are the companies who have delivered profit or the PAT quarter after quarter for at least 12 to 18 quarters, or you will find that the percentage is even lesser. So maybe, I think that percentage is 0.6% or something. Honestly, I didn't believe it, but I honestly don't have a data to verify it, but possibly I respect the person who spoke about it. If brand has to be in the business and the brand has to be relevant, I think brand needs to really cross, brand needs to become a brand of an individual. Let's take an example of a Modi, and I remember one word which everybody says, I am Modi, I am Chowkidar. And if I ask question to the people sitting here, do you remember any brand which has really lasted generations? According to you, can you name one brand which you think, or two brands, which you think has really, really lasted generations? Raymond's, Amul's, Kurlon, okay, Godrej. I think sometimes I feel that's a limitation, sometimes we think too linearly. I'm trying to provoke the rest of the panelists so that they can oppose me. Why brand needs to be owned by somebody? Modi is not owned by somebody. Modi is owned by that person. Just think of a brand, yoga, which is created in India. Do you think yoga is a brand? And the yoga as a brand has passed many, 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 many generations, has moved, this brand is making money, not for the brand creator, but its brand is solving people's problem. I think that's something which is extremely important brand has to do. Brand has established the trust. And then you will find there are many such brands which has lasted, because they stayed relevant. They stayed relevant for the age, whichever is that age, the digital age or whatever. So thanks, that's my opinion, and I'm sure here is IA.
Meera, IA number one.
Yeah, I think recognition, relevance. Recognition is really about the science, and today all the people over here will know, and since all of us are predominantly from the marketing fraternity, to get recognition, you need a specific number of frequencies to the selected audience. That's all. Right? And you can do it with digital, you can do it with offline, you can do it with a combination. Therefore, recognition is something that any and every brand, if it has the money and wherewithal, will be able to do. Right? Therefore, recognition is not something that you can stop a brand from having if it has money. The other part is what is relevance, and indeed the elections is the largest part. Is there anybody in the country who doesn't recognize Rahul Gandhi? No. Is there anybody in this country who doesn't recognize Narendra Modi? No. But then the relevant person actually got the higher mandate, right? So I think the difference is very clear. One is doable if you have money. One is something that you have to really construct and be very crafty in terms of how you get it.
It's not enough to have money, you're saying. Hmm? Well, the second is not enough to have money.
Yeah, and the second one, look at the, if you look at the largest corporate houses in India, you have the largest one in terms of market cap is Reliance, right? And you have several others including Tatas and Birlas. Who do you find more relevant? Whom do you connect with more?
Right. That's an argument we can have afterwards over tea.
Of course.
Samyukta wanted to say something.
I think also it's very important that a little bit of disagreement about only brands with money can actually build relevance, because sometimes you have very limited marketing budgets, which happens to many of us at some point in time when the finance team suddenly announces that there's a budget freeze. What do you do then?
No, sorry, one sec. I'm just going to interject for you. I think her point was that if you have enough money, you can build recognition.
Yeah.
Even with money, you can't build relevance, was the point. So you need to engineer the whole thing. You need to work very hard, clarity, all of those good things.
Yeah, just wanted to state a point here. Because this is, I think, again, since we're all from the marketing, advertising fraternity out here, budgets are something that we're quite constrained with many a times. In the biggest of organizations, best of organizations, it's always about the ROI that you get for every single thing that you put out there. I think relevance is something that also is very, very closely associated with resonance that you build with the audience. So for example, I think if I have to go back to what you said, sir, about brands that have lasted, brands that have been built to last, typical brands that come to mind is say a Coke or a Dove, you know, those are the kind of brands that all of us think of. But there are brands that fall off the wagon because they fail to be relevant at a particular point in time. Biggest example that we have is of Sony. Sony was known for Walkman, Sony was known for music, Sony owned that entire category. Sony taught all of us what it is to walk out on the streets with a Walkman in your ear. Like portable music was something that they created. And then suddenly, because that change took time. I think agility is also something that's a very core component of being very
relevant in the market.
Yeah. So sometimes you may build relevance, you may stay relevant over a period of time, but in the age that we are in, or any age for that matter, like I think we are talking about survival of the fittest and Darwin, change is the only constant, however cliche that may sound.
Agreed.
And then the brand then therefore needs to therefore be very agile in adapting to those changes as well to stay relevant.
Does the third IR want to violently disagree? Or?
Yeah, I agree and disagree to your point.
Okay.
There's nothing called what is brand relevance versus brand recognition. If you were to say, it's like from whenever we started branding, if there's no relevance, there's no recognition. So with relevance comes recognition. And any brand or any product for that has to be relevant to the end customer.
Yeah, but you do agree that there have been brands that have built high recognition and then fallen off the cliff.
See, that is again because you're not being relevant.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's
so
the only
we
part.
Can't say versus. One leads to the other, is what I'm trying to tell you.
And then it's about success.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
I think I also wanted to give a couple of examples. One was, you know, like Just Style. How many of us use Just Style over here? I think they advertise a lot, right? I think they have to miss Ayer's point on recognition, Meera Ayer, on. On being recognized but not being very relevant. Whereas I think also there is a play where, you know, if the product itself is relevant, you automatically, by building recognition, you get relevance. So real estate, we work a lot in the real estate space. What we have seen is because the product itself is relevant, people want to buy a house. So the brands which actually advertise and reach out to consumers automatically get a lot more trust and visibility. For example, if you enter the airport in Bangalore, you'll see like a Brigade or a Purvankara. So automatically the trust factor increases and they become more relevant brands compared to someone who's not advertising today.
Got it. Mangesh, your part of this?
Just one thing to add to that is I think relevance is also not monolithic anymore, right? It needs to be relevant to your user cohorts and you could have multiple of them. So just something to add to everything else that is said. Not looking at it as just one relevant brand for everybody, but sub-stories of relevance. And that is something that digital is enabling. So so that's just something to add.
Super. Okay. Come back to you guys in the end. I'm sure you have a point of view. But just move on to the next one, which is basically a substrata of relevance. You know, forever we've heard that businesses that command superior customer experience tend to do a 5 to 8x on earnings and growth. We know that metrics like NPS, that is the your you know advocacy score, and your repeat purchase, always help to keep you healthy in business. Fundamentally, it means you'll get you do not have a discount, and you get more people coming to you as a consequence of these two. And yet, all of us in this room will complain how, by and large, customer service on any almost anything sucks, right? Why is it? Do you think that you know businesses haven't quite got? I'm sure there are good examples of people who've got it, but it's exceptional. Why is it by and large we complain as consumers, we complain so much about customer experience, knowing full well that the health of a business and its metrics are largely dependent on these two scores?
So let me start with that. So one of the things that we've seen is just the amount of data that is available today and people's ability to process that and use that to improve customer experience. The ones that are doing it really well, the Amazons, the Swiggies of the world, are really good at understanding, processing, getting meaningful insights out of this data and taking action on it.
So your case is that digital can actually raise the bar on this?
Definitely. Digital is raising the bar on this. And most of the brands that are still focused on traditional, although that's a great mode of driving transactions, it's not probably the best way to understand very granular data.
I think, a lot of our clients are from older industries, and you know, digital is like a shock to their system. They have built legacy systems which.
Sorry, just a point. Sunil actually runs a digital agency. He's one of the founders.
So a lot of older companies have traditional structures. They have a customer support which is tuned to a certain level of engagement, turnaround times. And in digital, you need to respond within 5 or 10 minutes, right? So you see, even for passports, for example, for the government, a lot of people will tweet to Sushma Swaraj or the Ministry of for passport-related issues. Because the passport office is not tuned to respond within 48 or 72 hours. So digital is making them create shortcuts or patchwork, which makes them respond faster. But their legacy itself is not well built for that.
Sorry, before you answer, so do you think, anyone can answer this, do you think a faster response is equal to good experience?
I think today that's one of the prerequisites, because at a click you need 5 minutes, you need a Uber, passport. You don't want to wait for 2 weeks to get your passport. You want it within 24 hours.
So Meera?
So I started my career with Unilever, and there was this Lever Care at Unilever.com as an email ID, and there was also this calling number that used to be there. And each of us in the brand teams or whichever brands we used to manage, we used to every week get a download of all customer queries that came to us about our products or any kind of complaints that came to us, and we had to actually address that. And I remember that barely in a week I would get something close to, and this is for a portfolio of brands that I was handling, I used to barely get something like 5 to 7 such responses. Today digital has enabled every customer of your product or service to be able to instantly post both good and bad feedback. And unfortunately, the bad feedback is what gets posted much more in terms of percentages. And the good ones, whoever are happy, tend to just be happy and not quite act on it. And that has resulted in the need to be, and like he says, legacy systems are not tuned to that.
Correct.
And suddenly you find that where I was getting seven customer queries in a week has exploded to 7 million. What do you do? And how do you really deal with it?
So is it your point, and anybody can take on this, that digital is actually forcing a better quality of customer experience from
Absolutely.
Companies?
Absolutely. See, initially when customers got a quality of service that they either liked or disliked, they didn't have a medium to express it.
Right.
Right. Now that they have a medium to express it, suddenly everybody has to stand up and take note. Right? You never even got to know various things about your own product before in this kind of a magnitude.
So it goes back to the topic itself, survival.
Oh yes, totally.
Okay. Samita.
Yeah, so I think completely agree with what everyone's saying about this. It is about that speed to market. It is about understanding, again, it's going back to saying, I know who my customer is. I know which kind of customer. I think that is what digital lends itself today, which traditional media has still not managed to catch up to. We can never do away with traditional media, at least for now. But digital helps you understand. I can literally crawl through each of my pages, whether it's on Twitter or Facebook or Insta or Snapchat, wherever I am as a brand, I know exactly at what point in time why somebody was looking at my brand, what was the interaction that was happening. So when that particular persona of customer complains, and now the joke is that amongst the millennials that it's Twitter is being used largely to complain, not to say anything nice. So the agency that we're dealing with also right now who handles all of our mandate, 24-25 is their average age group. We have Gen Zers and we have millennials, most of them who are handling our account right now. For them, it's like Twitter is for old people. Facebook's for old people. And that's a place where people want to complain. So it's very important that as a brand, I'm able to immediately address. I think completely with you when you said that, that is the first thing. I just want to know that I am there for you.
Yeah.
You had an issue. Let me then come back to you and solve it. Then, of course, that's speed to then solving it. But I think that immediacy, and then as a brand, knowing what needs to be done, both those things digital does, which traditional can never do.
So do you think that...
And Ramesh, I just want to add one thing. Today, unfortunately or fortunately, the bar is being raised by a few.
Right.
And even if you don't overpromise, you actually underpromise, saying, you know, I will give you this. If somebody else is giving you more, even if you haven't committed to the customer to give only so much, customer still compares you with the yardstick of another competitor who's offering more or better.
Yeah.
Right, and therefore you have no choice either to be at the same level playing field, or else basically, you know, be open to a barrage of issues that will actually come. So it's also not about setting expectations right anymore.
Correct.
Right, because it's not about you setting expectations and people holding you accountable against those expectations.
Mm.
It's about people holding you accountable for expectations set by the topmost or the highest contender in that particular space.
Okay.
Which is very scary, sorry, but which is very scary because as a brand, sometimes you have people who have not even entered your store. Like when you do...
And already complaining.
And they've already complained just because, like, we had a case recently.
Parking was poor.
Yeah, literally. Somebody in Jalandhar, a 19-year-old kid in Jalandhar who wanted to buy a new pair of Reebok sneakers that had come out in the market. And he actually kept complaining till we had to tell him, listen, we're not going to give you anything. And that was a call we had to take because he said, main tweet karunga, main Facebook mein jaunga, main sab jagah pe media ko bulaunga, all of that. Which is a brand, after some time gets very scary because you don't know how to respond to customers like that. Because today media is out there for everyone.
Hopefully he's not a poster boy for everybody else. Okay, sorry.
He's not an influencer, we checked.
Just one thing, I think we are all talking about experience, you know, after the fact, like if something's gone wrong, you need to service. I think there's a lot that is possible even before from an experience standpoint, which is personalization, right?
Correct.
Being able to deal with different people, with different requirements, with different messages. And that is something also that's possible. So it's not always about solving problems. It's about making it easier and a better experience.
To actually go through the experience
also.
Super. Makes sense.
I just have a point,
sir.
Yeah. I just have a point because digital, it's not utilized by us in the way that we have to. There are bots talking to you most of the time.
Right.
And you don't really get answers from them. There is a plethora of options there, but we are really not using it to our advantage yet. So we should also keep that in mind as to how good is it going to be, unless of course we as marketers kind of really put in some effort into it.
Absolutely. Ashutosh, you wanted to make a point and we'll go to the next
section. You know, I'm looking at the time also, but you know, I thought, okay, you know, we are all speaking about the transaction, the bar and the service and the quality and the delivery and all that stuff. And just go 10, 15, 20 years back when you used to speak about the spare parts available, you know, the service available, and today nobody speaks about it. My opinion, the transaction is something which die super fast. I think brand needs to move away because, you know, few years down the line, a good transaction will be taken as a table stake. It needs to be, you know, good product. I'm sure nowadays at a home you see multi-brand environment where all ACs work fine, all refrigerator works fine. You have amazing experience out of all brands, but still you don't stick to the brand. Brand needs to connect emotionally. In the digital age, I think that to me is a challenge to the marketeers, that how do we connect emotionally to the consumer? How do we connect passionately to the consumer? One such brand, since we just saw the presentation of, you know, of Puma, I remember, you know, myself is a runner and there is a brand called Asics and doesn't advertise. Of course, now I do see some of their advertisement, but you know, it's been connected to some community very passionately and I'm sure there could be many more such brands. So I think we need to move away from the transaction very soon. Today we are comparing the transactions to the brick and mortar and old age setup. setup is changing, and I think we need to move on and connect to that one consumer, individual consumer. You know, that's what I feel.
It's a good segue into my next question, and we'll keep it short given time. Somebody like Amadeus says that 64% of worldwide travelers are willing to share all their data with you willingly, provided you can promise them a good engagement experience, which is really what he was talking about. Can you expand on that? I'm saying, why is it that we are still largely in a broadcast mode, if this were to be true?
Just to add to that, I think the digital age has actually opened up a lot of audiences. Mm. Earlier, the consumer segment was based on ACC, A, B, C, and so on and so forth. Right now, it is not about that at all. Mm. Every age group, every person within the same age group, where they're growing, what they're seeing, even within the same household, consume a different kind, I mean, they all consume different kinds of media. Mm. So engaging with each and every one becomes really relevant in this particular world, where it is not like, okay, I have one formula, let me just use it across. It doesn't work anymore, for any brands at all. So consumer connect is like very important to the last person.
Yes, Sunil.
Some brands.
You're the guy who should be answering this.
No, I think also, in the print era, like there used to be one creative, and you know that was the creative champion creative for the CEO, CMO, everyone was proud. It was plastered all over town. I think that legacy effect also still continues to some extent, where even on digital, brand wants to run one type of creative for a particular campaign or for a particular product. Whereas someone for ice cream, for example, I think Sam, you could share, like, you know, a millennial's ice cream taste will be very different from like a 25 to 30 year old and a 40 year old. So, but they still would want relatively similar communication or similar styling for different audience segments also.
No, but it's actually true. So, again, back to comparing 15 years back versus now, I used to brief my same agency, Lowlanders, for example, saying, yeah, we need a damn good key visual for this campaign, right? And that key visual only you will use for 6 months, right? And in fact, when I started on Dove, incidentally, on digital, you know, the conversation in the room was, yaar, ek dhasu creative banate and we will run it on Facebook for 6 months, right? And that was how naive we were, and we were like utterly, did not quite know it and understand it. And today, for the midlife set of creatives that we've gotten made for even the TV ads, I had literally 200 photo shoots done, 200 pictures finally to create a library to run with 6 months, right? So that's the kind of change that's happened because of digital.
Okay. One of you. Yeah. Okay. He's saying the IRs are taking.
So I'll just give an example. I think we are talking about all of this. So we had a men's innerwear brand, and we had two types of creatives, one with model, one without model. And of course, the brand was very proud about their creatives with model. And we said, we want to run all of these. We found that the images of the products without model worked very well in tier one. The images with model worked very well in tier two. Collectively, it was a very popular campaign and gave great results. So I think the choice that we had to make, that this is good, this is not, is gone. We need to put a lot out there in front of people and let algorithms choose what's working.
Actually, what she said at the beginning, it's really beginning to sound scary. How many businesses are going to survive? So if you think about it,
point on cost actually also.
Cost.
We kind of missed this, like, creating these campaigns, like 200 creatives, requires one time, and there's a cost element as well. So technology today has not scaled up to the level. It's getting there, where you can do 200 different types of creatives within a day, right? So say MedLife wants to start a campaign tomorrow, can you do 200 different creatives, 3 days? Yeah, so I think technology, you need to add to the cost. Most brands are not willing to add to that cost today, I think.
Oh, they're not, you're saying?
They're not, yeah.
Okay.
So I think what we've been doing, just to add to that point as an example. We is Baskin Robbins. So our consumer is literally your Gen Zers to your millennials to your older millennials. So that's essentially the classification. And then the rest of the world, of course. Instagram is a very big medium for us because that's prima facie where our audience is sitting, and then it's literally the same, but we go back to the tenets of what we learned at Unilever, where we have one key visual that we then use across whether it's Twitter, Facebook, any other medium that goes from there. So your core TG definition versus your communication TG definition, and then so on and so forth. What we've started doing from summer has been that we've gotten into topical content. So whether it was elections, or whether it was cricket, or whether it was a certain show with the series which just ended a couple of 3 Mondays ago, or another show with a young scientist, and you know which show also ended. So things like that, where we have actually picked up content that's very relevant, very topical, linked it back to our brand, and that's the kind of content that our digital team has been churning around on a daily basis. At literally like no cost, because you're not going out there and making any kind of a product shoot for it. I think that's the beauty of digital. Having said that, we still had to run a TV ad, and we still had to be there during IPL. We still had to do all of that. But today, digital lends itself to doing a lot more fun stuff that we couldn't have done even 10 years ago.
It does. My big question is, with the kind of disruption you're talking about, will survival rates get worse? I mean, just to put it in context, we're just looking at the data. Of all the Fortune 500 companies on the list today, only 54 of them have survived from 1955. So in less than 50 years, 90% of the Fortune 500 has gone out of the window. So is a situation like this going to make this worse?
Can I take that? I don't think it's going to be any different. We discussed this in the first in the first round of questions that you had asked us, that only thing that's constant is change. Companies that change and evolve and modify themselves to really move with the consumer trends will survive. Those that don't will die.
Okay, so my question came from the fact that, you know, 30 years ago, our ability to control the variables in our business in spite of difficult consumers was much higher, no? It seems, from what you guys are saying, it's much more difficult to control the consumer end than it was 30 years ago.
So I differ on this. I think that there is so much more data now. It is your ability to process data that's going to define whether you survive or not. I mean, 50 years ago, it was gut feel. It was many other things. I think it's a lot easier now. But the challenge is, how do you make, get signal out of the noise? And that's going to be the bigger challenge as against.
The point that I want to make is that how relevant is the product to the consumer? You know, and there are so many consumers right now, like the way she just mentioned about the Gen Z and everything coming in. Each and every person wants a different thing.
Yeah.
And there are going to be fragmented views about, you know, the product, the needs, everything is going to change.
Yeah.
And you being relevant is going to be difficult unless, of course, you really understand your audience. And that is the key thing that
people should. So you're definitely saying it's much harder work than 30 years ago.
It is going to be hard because it's also opening up a lot of products and companies are coming in. I mean,
you need a viable alternative, no? So I'm saying that, you know, just saying that, oh, I'm not happy with this doesn't mean that there is somebody else over there in the market already offering you that service.
Right.
I'll tell you, way back when Asian Paints came up with their entire Mera Wala Cream campaign, where they suddenly introduced computer and said that I will, you know, put this color ka so much, CYAN, and they basically started mixing and matching and created multitude or just exploded the sheer color choice that customers had. That was a breakthrough. That was like big, wow, right? But now they've also had to move away from that, and they've had to talk about all the issues that customers face, right, with respect to dust and with respect to some other things, monsoons, some all kinds of stuff. And now they even have bacteria resistant paint and whatnot. Right? So I'm saying that people are evolving, and then you will have to keep coming up with a new narrative, and that's really the marketing's job, right?
Definitely much harder work. Sounds like much harder work, definitely.
Yeah. But I also think that, going back to what Aarti said about the product relevance, I think it's not just the marketeer's job, or it's also about marketing ensuring that product quality. Marketing having much more stringent control over the quality of product that's going out there. Because I may have a brilliant marketing campaign, but if my product falls short, the customer is extremely unforgiving. The kind of hatred, the kind of barrage of, it's Scary. I'm going to go back to saying scary.
It is scary.
So you might have a great campaign that cannot overpromise. The product has to deliver first. If the product stays true, product stays relevant, and you don't act schizophrenic as a brand. I think that's the other scary part. If the brand keeps changing, like just because I'm adapting doesn't mean that I lose my true essence. I think that is the bigger challenge. How do you tread that fine line between staying true to who I am and then also being, you know, adapting and being agile with the market?
Which brings me to the last
time. Quick point. Actually, like a lot of the brands over here are older brands. I think it's also become a lot easier to build brands today, and which is why it's become tougher to survive. Because like, I mean, some of our clients within 6 to 9 months see amazing traction as brands, which was never possible 10 years back. Yeah. So I think the timelines have shrunk for building and decline. So it's,
exhilarating and it's...
And yeah, you die out also
scary as well.
That's right.
My last question, only last question, and this has basically deriving from what you said. See, one of the things that we've seen over the last 20 years of our work, almost a couple of decades, is that if you look at the value of businesses, right, only 1/4 is lying in the books. And 3/4 of the value of the business lying outside the books. And in that, 38% of value of business is coming from the brand on the average. Okay, it may swing here and there depending on what interbrand says at whatever point of time. But 38% is a big number. Now, therefore, my question is, what is really going to be the CMO's role 5 years from today in a scenario like this where digital is disrupting everything? Brands clearly are the arrowhead for the business. And yet, are we thinking beyond, you know, market opportunity and supply chain? What will be the role of the CEO strategically? For example, can I visualize a scenario in which we have got a half an hour slot only for the CMO to tell investors, to tell the board that here is the cause and effect relationship between the amount of money we are spending on branding, digital or otherwise, and the value that's been created for the shareholder, the role of the CMO. Yeah.
Great.
Yeah. Okay. Anybody?
So I think 2-3 things, going back to what we've been discussing, it's almost like a summation. I think equity is something that brands build. And brands' equity, the way we have learnt it from our Kotler days, is about asset and liability and all of that. I'm not talking numbers at all here. If we have to build equity in the customer's mind, and therefore your shareholder's mind, and even then your presentation to the board, if at all there's a, you know, utopian scenario like that where the...
It's already happening.
Excellent. Okay. I'm very happy to know that. So if there were a scenario like that, and like you're saying there is, I think it's very, very important to then ensure that you are able to be very, very, very patient as a brand. Because I think we talk about product, we talk about price, you know, again, if I have to go back to saying the 4 P's of marketing and however boring that sounds, we still get evaluated on those parameters only, however much we have evolved, however much you have data and science.
You're saying it's still very transactional.
It is extremely transactional. You are always asked, what are the, and this is true of any organization, any brand, service, product or otherwise.
Yeah.
How many number of new retailers are you getting in? How many number of new walk-ins are you getting in? You know, what are the number of people who have transacted more with you? Consumption, penetration, it's always the same metric. Why aren't we measuring things like, am I still relevant to that consumer? What kind of brand love? I think that is something that Unilever were taught us again about brand love. We learned about magic.
I agree. So what you're saying is it is transactional and it needs patience. I agree.
It needs a lot of patience, and that should be the 5th P on which marketeers should be evaluated.
Understand. But Meera, is it not important to measure?
It is super important, and I think we are oversimplifying it. There are lots of companies, and obviously a little more onto the traditional space, which still have a huge focus on brand. As a brand manager in Unilever, I remember my 3 KRAs. I had only 3 KRAs. One was to grow market share of my brand. Second was to ensure gross margins for my brand. And third was the brand equity, which was measured through, you know, a set of calculations done on the regular brand track that used to happen, right? But therefore, equity had an equal weightage.
Right.
And that means that Unilever knew inherently that brand is what the money is in.
Create value.
Right? And therefore, there are companies that do that. And yes, sadly, a lot of the digital companies and digital first companies, especially in the whole world of e-commerce, they start more as a product and tech company. And there is where I think this whole brand thought is completely missing in the initial years. But even there, you see, Anybody who started off by saying that my product and technology will take care of everything and will basically take me to the moon and stars realizes that they pretty much plateau, and then they have to resort to marketing and the entire brand building side to start taking the entire numbers up and go for the next wave of growth.
Okay.
Right? So it is not possible that you don't build equity and you actually, you know, get the numbers rolling and going all the time.
So cause and effect has to be established.
Absolutely.
Therefore, it's a board level topic anyway.
Absolutely.
So just to bring that point, it all depends on one key factor, which is called that brand valuation. It depends on who's really doing that valuation. You know, as long as it's just not based on the revenues just for the, you know, today and tomorrow, it is about you seeing the brand 10 years from now or 15 years from now. Whatever you work towards with short-term goals would automatically help you achieve that.
Well, the brand valuation is, you know, I think everybody now speaks about the brand valuation, GMV and, you know, all those things. Ultimately, you know, brand has to finally deliver money, you know. I think I feel there is a very strong fear of missing out. When we make 200 creatives, is brand still giving one message or brand is giving 200 messages? You know, the CMO needs to stand and say, this is my brand. Okay, brand message can change, but the brand ultimately needs to be true to, you know, 31 in, say, your case. You cannot be 27, 7, 29, 33, correct? Na? It needs to be, adaptation of this 31 can be 31 types, but ultimately 31, you know, the Baskins and Robbins 31, 31 remains 31. So the CMO's, of course, needs to, the role point of view, needs to speak this, the valuation, the equity, the contribution and all those stuff, but needs to stand firm, the brand love, what you say. You know, we can't, although she said that, you know, our relationships are, you know, changing, but we need to be rock solid with the brand. I think that's what I feel.
No, I'm saying today, I think industry has not defined a standard equation to basically come up with the correlation of brand to the numbers. If it does, then that is going to be the number one thing. Because look at the brands that have fallen from high pedestals. Look at how Maggie got affected when that entire controversy hit. Look at brand ambassadors, right? You know, one of the hottest people in the world, Tiger Woods, how his valuation completely fell. Right? It was all to do with the brand, right? So I think it's just about coming up with the equation. And if you know, yourself pointed out that if you look at the valuation of companies, 25% is the books, 38% is the brand. 38 is greater than 25.
Absolutely.
You know, you basically need an equation to connect the two. And then once you do that, it will start with that.
Well, the equation's already been built. There are ISO 9000 standards also on this. But I think it's some distance before it gets into a board meeting. What we're all hoping it does, especially in the digital age, is going to become even more important. A big hand for the three IRs and the three boys. Do we have time for two simple questions? Because I think it's only fair that they outnumber us and they should have a point of view at least twice. Two questions, okay. First one, yeah. Can you give him a mic? Tell us who you are.
Yeah, good evening to the panel. In today's scenario, AI and big data analysis, how much it help in brand building? Can you elaborate?
AI and big data, how much does it help in brand building?
So, I can take that. So, basically, you know, what AI allows you to do is process a lot of data to get meaningful insights out of it, right? So, what in the earlier days, which was one message going out to people, you measure, I think the cycles were much longer. What AI and big data or a lot of data allows you to do is measure a lot of things at one time and come up with meaningful insights based on which decisions can be taken. I think that's the biggest value.
I think the way we use AI for better brand building is by personalization, right? It allows you to reach different creatives. You can upload like 50 different creatives or 200 like Meera mentioned, and see which creative works for which audience type. So AI decides who to show which type of creative automatically. So you don't need a manual mapping of show this creative to this audience.
Super. One last question.
Hello, yeah.
Before we get beaten up.
Hello. Yeah. My name is Alec Banerjee. My simple question is to the panel, can we have one or two examples of brands that have stayed relevant over the last 10 years. We talked a lot about relevance. So can you have, do you have any examples where two Indian examples? Where the
brand each of us can give you three.
So,
but anyway.
I mean, I come from e-commerce, so I would say Flipkart. You know, 10 years ago, it was a brand about books. You could go get books there. Today, you can buy many other things. It stayed relevant. It's moved with times. It's also moved into fashion and other categories. So I think that's one example I would like to give.
Many, I think, Cadbury's, I would say chocolates. You know, they redefined chocolates, Titan watches. I think there are too many to count, actually.
Yeah, hi. Good, you know, I saw you. I think you have asked a difficult question. I'm not going to give an answer. I'm just trying to modify your question. Brand which is born in last 10 years and made profit. Do you have names in your mind? So just, I'm leaving this thought.
Good thought.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you. In conclusion, I have only two things to say. One is, it's obviously looking very, very scary with the consumer completely and totally in control of the conversation today because of digital. Secondly, I might add that it's equally exhilarating, because the number of things that you can do with digital is has obviously moved 10x. With that, all I need to say is thank you to each of the six panelists, the three Aidas and three boys. I was completely and totally not distracted, which obviously means that they had my attention. I hope they had yours too. Thank you very much for being a great audience.